Einstein, in his 1905 paper on special relativity, introduced two seemingly innocent postulates, one that the velocity of light is the same in all inertial frames, and in particular is the same in both directions. And by an inertial frame, we mean any frame which is at rest relative to the fixed stars or moving at a uniform velocity with respect to another inertial frame. And the other postulate is that the laws of physics are the same in all inertial frames. Another way to say that is that it is impossible to tell by any experiment, including experiments that use light, whether one is truly at rest or moving at a uniform velocity. So one, the velocity of light is the same in both directions in all inertial frames, and two, it is impossible to tell whether you're truly at rest or moving at a uniform velocity. Now, these seemingly innocent postulates have very unexpected consequences, and in an attempt to derive these consequences, Einstein often made use of Gedanken experiments or thought experiments involving a moving train. And this apparatus is nothing more than the physical realization of this abstract experiment that Einstein would do, which will help us to understand some of the unexpected consequences of the two postulates of relativity. Now, what we'll do is try to make measurements in two inertial frames, namely the station frame and the train frame, and try to relate the results of measurements between the two frames. In particular, let's start off with trying to make this simple experiment of measuring the length of a moving meter stick. Measuring the length of a fixed meter stick, in other words, one that's at rest in our own frame, is not a serious problem. You just lay it down, pace off the distance between one end and the other, and that is the length of your fixed meter stick. The question of measuring the length of a moving meter stick is a little bit more complicated, but we will choose the following scheme to measure the length of the moving meter stick. We will say, let's mark where its ends are at a particular time, and then at our leisure, pace off the distance between these two marks and claim that to be the length of the moving meter stick. Well, let's do that experiment. Here is a moving meter stick. Let's mark where its ends are at a particular time, let's say at quarter of. Here it is, quarter of now. I put a mark there. And at quarter of, here's the clock over here. Quarter of, I put a mark here. And now we can come and measure at our leisure the distance between those two marks and say that is the length of the moving meter stick. Now, some of you may have objected at this procedure because you said, well, we didn't quite mark the ends at the same time. And I claim, well, how can I tell time? I use the two clocks. They both read the same time. And you say, aha, the two clocks aren't synchronized. And you're right. They're not synchronized. They're just two random clocks that could be reading random times, as they indeed are. So the question is, how do we synchronize two distant clocks? We have to be careful in synchronizing these two clocks not to violate two postulates of relativity. And in particular, we'll make use of the two postulates of relativity to synchronize these two clocks. Let's assume that the two clocks that are an equal distance from the center of the station, and let's in fact place them at an equal distance from the center of the station, is that clock. And the right-hand clock will place over here. Okay, so the two clocks are at the same distance from the center of the station. And now, if we set off a firecracker at the center of the station, and the two clocks are indeed synchronized, then they should receive the light at each end at exactly the same time, or the clock should read the same time when they receive the flash of light as it leaves from the center of the station, because we know the light travels at the same velocity at the same speed in both directions due to Einstein's first postulate. So let's set off this firecracker in the middle of the station and read at what time it arrives here and what time it arrives at the other end. And the light arrives at this end just about noon, and it arrived here before noon. So obviously these two clocks were not synchronized because they didn't read the same time. And in fact, this one arrived here about 10 minutes too early. Let me set it that way. And in fact, you can see these two clocks are approximately synchronized. Now let me set them this way. And to do this accurately, let's in fact repeat the experiment. not so much to do it accurately, but to do it properly. This is not an experiment where we would get accurate results. But anyway, we set off a firecracker in the middle. We step back and read what time each of these clocks reads when the flash of light reaches it. And this clock reads about 20 of, and that one read about 20 of. The two clocks are indeed synchronized. Okay, now, this seems like such a trivial experiment to do, you sort of wondered why we even bothered. After all, these two clocks appeared to be going together. You can see them ticking together. And in fact, you can assume a whole ensemble of clocks here. They would all be ticking together, and that's what you normally mean when you say that the clocks are synchronized. They're all reading the same time. But the reason why I was so careful in synchronizing these two clocks is we will have to do the same thing on the train. Remember, Einstein's second postulate says it's impossible to tell if you're truly at rest or moving, and also says that the velocity of light is the same in both directions, no matter what inertial frame you're in. Let's do exactly the same thing to see if the clocks on the train are synchronized. We can set the clocks on the train moving. Let's set off a firecracker at the middle of the train and see if the two clocks at the beginning and at the end of the train are synchronized. Well, the firecracker goes off. This one reads about 20 of, and this one, 20 of has already passed, and the flash still hasn't arrived there. What conclusion do we draw? We draw exactly the same conclusion that we did in the lab when we did the experiment in the laboratory frame, that these two clocks are not synchronized. They did not read the same time when the flash of light reached each end. And what we have to do is we have to adjust one of the clocks and repeat the experiment until eventually they read the same time. Right, let me set the time the way I believe it should be. And let me also set this one in the middle and prove later that the clocks are indeed synchronized. Okay, I claim that now these clocks are synchronized. Let's in fact verify this by repeating our experiment. We'll set off a firecracker in the middle of the train and see what time the flash reaches each end of the train. So the firecracker went off. It reaches here at about 20 after. And the flash of light reaches the front end of the train right about now, which is about 20 after. We therefore conclude that the clocks on the train, the front clock and the rear clock, are now synchronized because they read the same time as they should, according to Einstein's first postulate. The light travels the same speed in both directions. And we know that the distance from here to the front and from here to the back are the same. Therefore, they must read the same time. Now, let's, in fact, verify that these two clocks are synchronized with each other. We'll do exactly the same sort of experiment. We'll set off a firecracker at the midpoint of those two clocks and see what time the flash reaches each of these two clocks. So the firecracker goes off. It reaches here about quarter after, and the flash of light reaches here at about quarter after. So this clock and this clock are synchronized. We'll leave it as an exercise to the student to prove that this clock and this clock are also synchronized. So we now have a whole set of clocks that are synchronized in the laboratory. And again, picture in your mind's eye a whole ensemble of clocks all ticking together. And it would be nice to picture an ensemble of clocks on a train. It's a little bit more complicated to picture it, but nevertheless, you can do so. But at least these three clocks are synchronized with each other. And now let's go back to our experiment of trying to measure the length of a moving meter stick. Okay, so we will now try to measure the length of this moving meter stick in the laboratory frame by indicating where its ends are at a particular instant of time, at a particular time according to our own clocks, of course, the laboratory clocks. And we will do so by putting these markers down, let's say, indicate where the ends of this meter stick are at midnight. Here, this end is here at midnight. This end was, of course, here at midnight because there was this imaginary clock that read midnight at that when that point was over here. And now the distance between those two markers is the length of that moving meter stick. Now the people on the train can do the same thing. They can take this meter stick of ours and measure its length by marking where in the laboratory where in the train the ends of our meter stick are at a particular instant of time. So let's assume that they mark in their frame where its ends are at midnight, and the train starts moving. Here it is, midnight, and they put a marker over here, and midnight hasn't quite come yet. Here it is, midnight, right about here. That's this end was over here when this clock read midnight, and now at their leisure, they measure the distance between these two marks with their meter stick and say that's the length of our meter stick. Now notice something very peculiar. One is that we measure the length of their meter stick to be approximately the same as ours. The distance between these two marks is the length of their meter stick. This is our meter stick. We measure the distance to be essentially the same. And they measure the length of our meter stick to be the distance between these two marks, which is appreciably shorter than their meter stick. Now, this is very serious because it perhaps offers some criterion of telling who's really at rest and who's moving. We could argue that the people who measure the same length, namely us, are the ones that are truly at rest, and the people who measure a shorter length or the wrong length are the ones that are moving, thereby violating Einstein's second postulate of relativity, that it is possible to tell if you're truly at rest or moving. But that's not where the flaw lies. The flaw is not in Einstein's postulates, but in these meter sticks, that this was not the appropriate meter stick for the people on the train. This was longer than the meter. If the people on the train had used the appropriate meter stick, this one, then we would restore the symmetry. And let me demonstrate that by redoing the experiment. First, we will measure the length of the train's meter stick by indicating where its ends are in our frame at a particular instant of time, at a particular time according to us. Okay, let's start the train moving and mark where its ends are at half past. So, well, let me start that again because the marker would have fallen behind the clock. Let's mark where its ends are a quarter after. So a quarter after, this end was over here and this end was over here at quarter after. And we say, all right, the length of the train's meter stick is a distance between these two marks and is not the same as our meter stick. Our meter stick is this long. The length of the train's meter stick seems to be shorter than ours. But now let's repeat the experiment and have the people on the train measure the length of our meter stick. Okay, let's assume the people on the train measure where the ends of our meter stick are at a particular instant of time. Let's say at half past. At half past, this end was over here. And at half past, this end is over here. So they measure the length of our meter stick to be the distance between those two yellow marks. And they compare it with their meter stick and conclude that our meter stick is shorter than theirs. Now we have restored the symmetry. Namely, we measure the length of their meter stick to be shorter than ours. They measure our meter stick to be shorter than theirs. And in fact, if this is done properly, the ratio by which they're shorter would be exactly the same. And it is, again, impossible to tell who's truly at rest and who's moving.